Welcome to Creating and Managing a Private Cloud with System Center 2012. Today, we have a lot of great content for you, so thank you so much for joining us. I'm Simon Perryman, I'm here with Anant, and we have two great days of content for you, all about how we deploy, manage, and operate the Microsoft Private Cloud. Let me introduce myself. I'm Simon Perryman, a technical evangelist with Microsoft Corporate. I'm based here in Redmond, Washington, and my focus is all around private cloud technologies with virtualization, System Center, Windows Server, and all of these various components that contribute to the Microsoft Private Cloud. My background is I spent 4 years at Microsoft as a program manager working on high availability technologies, and I've contributed to various books, patents, and other technologies. And I'm here joined today for the first module with Anant. Why don't you introduce yourself?
Thank you, Simon. Thanks a lot, everybody, for joining in. My name is Anant Sundaram, and I'm part of the System Center marketing team, and I'm very excited to be here. Over the last 8 or so years that I've been at Microsoft, I've done a variety of roles. I started with Microsoft IT, actually managing and leading application teams, and then I became an IT pro, you know, hopefully, which a lot of you folks in the audience are as well. And I got to play an active role in service delivery for Office 365, and then it was called BPaaS. And then I spent a couple of years actually being part of our worldwide team, which runs and manages Microsoft vast data center and networks. So again, a lot of fantastic IT pro experience. So all this is to say, I can hopefully touch on a few things that are close to your hearts and minds today as we go through this conversation.
Great. So you've been in the trenches. You've experienced it. So you know what a lot of our IT pros are dealing with today, how they manage these large, dynamically growing data centers. We're going to hopefully show you how the Microsoft Private Cloud is not only going to make your jobs easier, but it's going to save your company money as well. Now, as we look through the agenda over the next 2 days, we've broken this down into 9 modules. We're going to start with Anant giving a high-level introduction explaining, you know, what is the Microsoft Private Cloud, what are the key benefits, and how does System Center 2012 fit in? After that, we've broken down the days with day one focusing on deployment and configuration, day two focusing on monitoring and operating the environment. And within those 2 days, we're going to have 3 additional presenters. Kenan Owens is going to come in and talk about the private cloud infrastructure and the infrastructure components. So this is really looking at the hardware, looking at the compute resources, networking, storage. And then not only how do we manage that, but how do we optimize it for the private cloud to do things such as resource pooling, dynamic provisioning, rapid deployment. Next, we're going to move on and speak with Sean Christensen, who's focusing on service delivery and automation. So this is essentially how does the IT department fit in between deploying the services and between the application owner or developer that creates it. So not only how do we efficiently deploy these services, but over time, how do we then automate it and build efficiency into the process so the IT pros are no longer doing these repetitive day-to-day tasks, but they can spend more time focusing on enhancing the business, adding new services to the business, and making it more responsive to needs. Finally, we're going to work with Adam Hall, who's going to talk about application management. So this is focusing on the end application owner or the application developer, and how we can make them have an optimal experience of working in a private cloud with things such as self-service and deep application monitoring and insight. But first, I'm going to turn it back over to Anant, who's going to cover the high-level overview of System Center 2012. In this module, we do not have any demos, but please stay tuned. There will be a lot of demos coming up. And you can follow us throughout both of these days on Twitter using hashtag MSJumpstart. So please live chat with us, send us your questions. We have not only myself responding to questions, but we have a great team of people behind the scenes supporting us with various technical evangelists, product managers, and other Microsoft staff who are also experts on the Microsoft Private Cloud to really give you an interactive experience. So please ask us questions from the chat queue and follow us on Twitter at MSJumpstart. So why don't you tell us about the evolution of the data center and how we get to the Microsoft Private Cloud?
Thank you, Simon. In this conversation, like Simon was saying earlier, you should think of this as being a high-level overview of the Microsoft Private Cloud and how System Center is one of the key elements in enabling this. So there are three, you know, parts to this conversation roughly, right? So the first part will be just kind of grounding all of us in the taxonomy and Microsoft's perspective on the private cloud and how our solution is sort of different. And then we'll get into a little bit of how System Center's capabilities actually help deliver on the private cloud promise. And then we'll close a little bit with some of the components within System Center 2012, right? Hopefully, right, all of us walk out of this conversation thinking, gosh, Microsoft is doing a lot of things to make our life simpler. It's actually making concepts like cloud computing very approachable to us, you know?
Well, that's certainly the goal. Let's hope we deliver.
Yeah, great, great. So we certainly want to make your lives easier, and hopefully, you know, you take away a lot of things which you can learn and do with us as we walk along this journey together. So with that said, you know, the first thing I want to talk about is, you know, we as Microsoft, while we are trying to figure what technologies to invest in or what type of products are customers asking of us, we do a lot of work to kind of keep on top of market trends, right? And one of the things that we are seeing in the data centers that you folks manage is that you're going from just deploying to physical machines to virtual machines, and then even beyond that to things like private and public cloud computing, right? We'll get into the specific definitions on these, but for now, we see this as being some sort of a secular trend, right? So we're seeing this across geographies. We're seeing that the number of virtual machines or instances has actually exceeded the number of physical instances that are out there. Can you believe it? You know, both in terms of...
That's only been over the last 3-5 years as well. We've really seen this rapid growth in virtualization.
Absolutely.
And, you know, what's kind of ironic there is we have this problem of server sprawl, and virtualization was supposed to solve that. Now we have the problem of VM sprawl. But hopefully, private cloud with our elasticity, we're going to help solve that problem as well.
Absolutely. So, you know, yes, the number of virtual machines has gone beyond the number of physical, but then that's created a lot of other complexities, which hopefully, you know, models like private and public cloud computing will help us solve. Right, but this is a trend which you guys should go back to your respective organizations and see if this trend is kind of realistic and if you're seeing that as well, and what can you do to sort of help it along, because we see a lot of benefits. So let's then get into what are those drivers or benefits that are actually making some of these trends happen, right? So we see three of them, right? So we think of them as being agility, focus, and economics. So let's talk a little bit about each of these three in turn, right? So the first thing around agility, and the thing that matters for you as an IT pro, is to make sure that your internal customers, that is your line of businesses and your application developers, are your biggest fans, right? How do you make them your biggest fans? By delivering things faster, and more importantly, being able to respond to unanticipated changes in demand that they might have, right? You've got to understand that they're also going through a period of change, a lot of dynamic business requirements and so on, and you've got to be on top of them.
Well, here's one of the challenges, you know, a lot of companies have been inhibited by their IT before. You know, they have a great business idea, they have a new service that they want to bring out as quick as possible, but IT department says, we need to order servers, we need to deploy them, join them to the domain, it's going to take 3 months. But we want to get out of that model of having IT hinder progress. We want IT to enable the business, enable the services, and really allow the business to focus on their core business, and just allow IT to help enable that. So, I mean, tell us a little more about the focus.
Absolutely. So, from a focus perspective, one of the things I constantly ask customers is, or, you know, a lot of you folks as well, frankly, is how much time do you spend in doing repetitive mundane activities like, you know, patching a server or recycling DNS, versus doing things which really matter to your business in terms of core application and service deployments, and things which really, you know, would be creating more and more business impact. And the answer I get, like, gosh, we spend 70% doing things which are more maintenance-like, and just 30%. You know, and I can tell you, my experience at Microsoft IT is that we were at that point a few years ago as well, and now we've sort of moved the pendulum in a big way on that. But the point here is that you can get the cloud, one of the key promises of the cloud is that you can get away from that day-to-day, you know, mundane
repetitive tasks,
and, you know, add more and more value to your business and more value to your own careers, right? That's what we're all here about.
So you're saying the IT pro is going to move more away from doing the repetitive tasks to really enhancing the business, making the business have more value because they can more quickly deploy services, make more revenue.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Doing things which are core to the business, right? And the last point around economics, right? And again, I tend to be blown away by responses I get to this question. What percentage of the data center resources you've deployed are really being used, right? And I get amazed when customers say, gosh, 10 to 15%, right? That's a massive amount of over-provisioning, which, you know, which no financial controller would be happy about, right? You know, I from my personal experience, a lot of early successes in my career have come from actually, you know, doing a quick heat map of where is Microsoft's own data center resources being used, right? And kind of coming up with smart proposals to drive that utilization up, right? We did a bunch of TCO studies which actually proved that, you know, the TCO of managing a physical server is roughly 10 times that of managing an equivalent server which is deployed in a private cloud computing model. And wow. We've got a ton of data. We'll walk through some of that stuff, right? But it's that economics and the fact that, you know, we've got just one systems administrator managing around 2,000 to 3,000 servers versus in a lot of feedback that I get from enterprises saying, gosh, we have one admin per 30 to 50 servers. Right? That's a big statement of economics.
It is. And I mean, I think it's important to think that it's not just that initial capital expenditure, right? It's not just that I no longer need to go out and buy a new server because I can use a VM, but it's that operational cost as well. Again, instead of doing that repetitive task again and again, we're building in automation. So that operational expenditures, they're going to go down, along with the capital expenditures. So, you know, tell your CFO, we like the private cloud. It's going to help everyone in this
yep,
case.
Absolutely. So those are the drivers, right? And what are some of those principal attributes or tenets which actually, you know, make some of those benefits come real, right? So there are four of them which actually define cloud computing in general, right? So the first one is this notion of pool resources, where you look at your whole data center as, you know, including storage, network, and compute as one logical entity or one single pool of resources, right? Just imagine what this does for your role and your life, right? As an IT pro, you get full centralized control of all the data center investments that your organization has made, right? So you can go back to your application counterparts and, you know, have a frank conversation and say, hey guys, you just tell me what your application needs and the SLA your application needs, and I'll make sure that we've got the infrastructure delivered at the right time and in the level of quality of service that you're looking for, right? Today, we still see a lot of application owners coming in saying, hey, you know, I want this type of server, I want this type of storage, and so on and so forth. So basically, by pooling resources, we are actually enabling you guys to do what you are best at, which is managing the infrastructure in an efficient fashion, and you're allowing application owners to do what they are best at, which is actually building apps, right? So pooling of resources is a very key element of, you know, of cloud computing in general, and this is something which actually might require some, you know, some conversations or some political battles as well to make sure that, you know, we are all doing the right thing for the business, right? But it's a key element of cloud computing. The second one is self-service. And once you've sort of pooled resources, you can actually come up with some sort of a self-service experience or a portal where your internal customers or application guys can actually go and provision stuff, they can manage stuff, they can make changes to their applications and so on. In other words, you can provide that sort of a sandbox environment, right? Related back to the agility piece that we were talking about, right? So if pooled resources was about economics, this is about agility. The third point is around elasticity, right? And this is the notion that your data center resources can sort of scale up and down to accommodate your application's requirements or your business requirements dynamically, right? And again, it goes back to that agility concept that we were speaking about earlier.
It does. And, you know, most people I hear, you know, speak to about this, they think elasticity just means being able to scale up quickly. So you have a new service, you monitor how that service is growing, and you immediately go and deploy these apps, these VMs, to go and work with that increase in demand. But an important part that other people don't realize is that elasticity means scaling down as well. So if you've deployed this service, it was popular. You know, maybe it was for a one-time event, such as the launch of a movie. Once that's over, those resources aren't being used. Scaling back down and reallocating those resources back to your storage pool, back to your compute pool, your network pool, that's equally important as well. And that can also be provided with automation in the private cloud. So think both scaling up and scaling down when you pick these key apps.
Absolutely. The last tenet here is usage-based, right? A lot of you say, gosh, we want to make sure that our internal customers are really aware of the kind of data center resources they're consuming, right? And show back a report which actually says, hey, you consume this amount of infrastructure, you consume this amount of, you know, network, storage, compute, and so on and so forth, and have a way to actually say, you know, this is how much it actually cost us to deliver that amount of infrastructure to you guys, right? It may not, you don't need to go back to charge back, right? In other words, you don't need to charge back your internal customers, because a lot of you tell us that, gosh, this is all funny money and so on and so forth. But we believe that driving behavior by tracking usage of your crucial data center resources is a key tenet of cloud computing.
I mean, that's great. You know, as you mentioned, right, it's not just about being able to charge the business unit, because sometimes it is all shared money. But it's also good to help you plan your data center utilization. If you're monitoring how your servers are used, your VMs are used, what capacity is being taken, that really helps you with your financial planning over the next quarter, the next year, because you kind of have a baseline of this hardware utilization. So just better economics, again, with the private cloud.
Absolutely. So that being said, these are the four tenets that you would see in any cloud computing solution. But then a lot of you folks come back and say, gosh, we've got a business which is highly regulated, right? So we want to make sure that we have absolute control over the data that goes out of our firewall, right? That's one aspect of it. There are others among you who say, you know, we've seen public cloud providers, but they offer just 3-9 SLAs, whereas a lot of my apps need more than that, and which is very specific to my own business's requirements. So we believe that the private cloud computing model is something which is in that sweet spot where you get a level of extra control, a level of extra customizability in a set of data center resources that are dedicated to your organization-specific applications, right? So it's kind of dedicated to you, and we feel that that's an important ask that a lot of customers are actually having of us. So you might be wondering, how did Microsoft know that some of these benefits are real? How did you folks come up with some of these attributes, right? It turns out that Microsoft has been delivering cloud services for the last 20 years, right? So think about services like Hotmail, which has been in existence for a long time. Also think about services like Bing or Windows Azure, which are kind of highly scaled cloud services. So we've had a lot of learnings. We've invested a lot in data centers around the world. You see a lot of them pictured out here in your screen. And, you know, we've kind of progressed so much that we initially started thinking of servers in these data centers, right? Then we started thinking of, gosh, we need to be more efficient than that. And can we have racks of servers which are pre-configured and we just roll them into our data centers? Then we went to containers, which are basically, you know, a set of 250 servers which are wrapped in an ice cube of sorts, right? And from then on, we've actually progressed to prefabricated data centers. It's like saying, gosh, I've got a ready data center which I can ship anywhere in the world, right? So we've seen a significant evolution in terms of how we think about our data center infrastructure. Right? We've also done a lot of innovations like, hey, can we actually lower OPEX by using ambient air cooling, right, in a place like Dublin where temperatures tend to be sub-zero a lot of the year, right? Or how do we use recycled water to cool this data center so that we, again, you know, spend less on power, to Simon's point earlier, right? So we are driving down CAPEX in terms of how we figure out the SKUs that use power optimally, as well as driving down OPEX in terms of what it takes to operate these data centers.
So I have a question from the queue here. I'm not sure if you can answer this, but the question is, what percentage of Microsoft IT is using virtualization? Or, you know, out of all the servers out there, do we know how many are virtualized versus non-virtualized?
I think it's a good question. I don't know the exact split, but I do know that there is a clear roadmap that we've put together within Microsoft IT, where we've sort of earmarked all the applications into three buckets, where we said, look, you know, there are applications which are low-hanging fruit, which can go to, frankly, even the public cloud, like Windows Azure. There are applications which have a certain level of security and privacy requirements, which can be built into a private cloud-like infrastructure. And then there are applications which cannot fit into a cloud computing model for various constraints, and those need to be virtualized. So we've kind of got a clear roadmap in terms of how we are looking at evolving our data centers. Certainly, we can do some follow-up and figure out the exact split of virtual versus private versus...
Right. Well, I know, for example, Microsoft.com, which is one of the most popular internet properties in the world, that is entirely running on Hyper-V, on top of a failover cluster, so fully virtualized with billions of page requests every day. So if you're wondering, you know, can Hyper-V, can the Microsoft private cloud scale to a large property? Absolutely. Microsoft.com is a prime example there.
Great. So just continuing on this journey around Microsoft's own learnings, right, from the public cloud and operating large-scale cloud services. So the first principle that we've kind of learned by operating these large-scale data centers is just this notion of standardization, right? So if you walk into any of our data centers, be it Chicago, be it San Antonio, or wherever, you will see that we are kind of trying to standardize around a limited number of storage, compute, and network SKUs. The reason, you know, for us, the primary driver is scale. But you will see in subsequent sections of this presentation how we have actually used this principle to get some of these benefits of standardization and low unit costs as a result of doing that to you for leverage in your own data centers as well, right? This is key. The second point is the fact that application services that run in our global data centers are kind of inherently resilient, right? So we assume that failures are going to happen, and some of those things are actually built into the application. So if a piece of infrastructure that an application is hosted on goes down, we just actually move the application over to another piece of infrastructure versus taking the application down, right? So that's the point around SLA-driven architectures. With the scale at which we operate it, which we operate in, which is like hundreds of thousands, even millions of servers, we actually require a high degree of process maturity, right? So if a particular piece of equipment in a server rack goes down, we don't send a mechanic or a support engineer to actually fix that immediately, right? So we wait for a certain section of that rack to become unusable before we actually dispatch someone to fix it, right? Before we dispatch a technician to fix it. So again, if a server goes down, we try and patch it remotely. And if that doesn't work, we just take down the server because a lot of our, like I said, you know, because of the standardization, we exactly know the type of SKU that we are dealing with, and we're able to remote in and do all that cool stuff, right? So you guys should be thinking about, you know, the right set of automation tools that you should actually invest in to make sure that, again, you know, you get out of the business of doing repetitive tasks again and again. And even after doing all this, right, in terms of standardizing infrastructure, driving process, making sure that there's guidance around how applications should be written, we still allow all of those service owners to have a level of delegation and control so that they can play around in their own sandbox and do things which are right for their own business, right? So we want to make sure that customers have a self-service experience which we, as IT pros who run Microsoft's infrastructure, can delegate and control in the right fashion, right? So again, these are some of the key learnings by operating services like Hotmail, Messenger, Office, and Windows Azure, and so on. And we are certainly going to bring these learnings to your data center and make sure that you can take advantage of some of this, right? So think of what we've learned in 20 years. We are trying to compress and get to you through products like Windows Server and System Center. So then the question you might ask is, okay, so I need to build a strategy. You know, my CIO or CFO has come to me and said, hey, I need you to think about how to build a business case and figure out our roadmap to get into this private and public cloud computing models from where we are, right? So what is Microsoft's strategy and vision, and how do your offerings sort of fit into our endeavor to do this, right? So the first thing you should understand is we've got two platforms, right? A public cloud platform, which is Windows Azure, which actually offers the base storage, compute, and network by the hour, as well as higher order relational services like SQL Azure, right? For example, a relational database. And then we've got the private cloud platform, which is essentially, you know, a general purpose Windows Server, which actually runs on 75% of the world's installed base. And then System Center, which is the layer of management on top, which is optimized for the Windows platform, right? So inherently, there is symmetry between these two platforms, right? So if you peel Windows Azure, what you will see inside essentially is the Windows Server technology, right, which we've sort of scaled out or fanned out. And then again, in Windows Server, you know, you'll hear some more about this as we go along. We are building in a lot of learnings from operating Windows Azure into Windows Server. So there's a lot of symmetry in these platforms, right? And then we've got these application services, right, which could be productivity services like Office 365 or business applications like Microsoft Dynamics. And again, we've got versions of this on-premises as well as in public clouds, right? Again, you should think about how comprehensive our offering is. But what really is unique about Microsoft's strategy is what we call these common technologies, right? These are common identity, common virtualization, common management, and common development. These tie together both of these platforms. And we believe that these are what is what makes our strategy and our approach to hybrid IT very unique, right? Let me kind of quickly give you a few examples on each of these, right? If you think about common identity, right, a lot of you folks are very, very familiar with Active Directory, right? So what we are doing is allowing you to sort of federate Active Directory for public cloud applications as well, so that your application owners can have a single sign-on experience, right? We've seen Coca-Cola enterprises actually implement this solution using a mixture of on-premises SAP and Active Directory with Microsoft Office 365. So you should actually check out that that piece of fantastic work that Coca-Cola has done using Common Identity. Then with Common Virtualization, we actually enable you to turn on application portability, right? You can, today, you can actually rehost a Windows Server 2008 R2 VHD on Windows Azure with a technology called VMroll, right? With Common Management, we'll talk a little bit more about System Center. You basically have this single view or common console for your application owners across private and public clouds, and you as an IT pro have full control because you delegate that authority to your application owners to access those applications. Finally, with Common Development, what we say is we've got a fantastic set of development tools in .NET and Visual Studio, and whatever your developers can build using .NET and Visual Studio can run and be deployed in Windows Azure or in Windows Server, right? So these are these commons which make our vision around cloud optimizing every business come real, right? So if you look at private cloud, it is, again, this support for the commons, our vision around enabling your endeavor towards hybrid IT, and lowering down your total cost of ownership, which we think is different. And on the public cloud, again, we are delivering with Windows Azure a fantastic general purpose platform with, you know, not only the base services, but also higher order bits like a relational database as well built in.
And don't forget, these are the same tools that you've been using a long time. Whether it's Visual Studio, your developers have been using that for a decade or longer. Yeah. Windows Server with Active Directory since, what, 2000 or earlier.
Absolutely.
A lot of people have been using it. So remember, moving to the private cloud, it's gradual, but you're using the same skill sets that you've been using for decades already. It's not a big shift to something brand new. And even if you think about moving to Windows Azure, our public cloud offering, again, these same tools, whether it's Active Directory, whether it's monitoring with System Center packs for Azure, it's the same tools that you're already familiar with. So don't be afraid. Try it out. The path will be gradual. You know, it's not going to happen overnight, but it is possible, and it's not that hard to make this transition.
Yeah, totally. I mean, one of the things which we've been thinking about as we build the strategy is making sure that it's grounded in the realities of our customers. And you guys have so many investments with us over the past many years. We want to make sure that you can carry that forward as you head into this world of hybrid IT, right? So then what are some of the fundamental tenets behind which the private cloud solution is based on, right? And how is our solution sort of different from what you might be hearing from some of the other folks in the marketplace who are also offering the Microsoft, who are also offering private cloud solutions, right? So there are four things, right? The first thing is that we believe that the Microsoft private cloud is all about the app, right? And this, you know, and through my experience in Microsoft IT, this is something which I really learned there and internalized there. Gosh, I mean, all the infrastructure that I would deploy as an IT pro would really matter or be impactful only if the businesses actually deploy and productively run applications on top of them, right? I also used to be amazed at the amount of inspection the CIO would have directly to any performance or availability issues with revenue impacting applications. So it's really all about the application, right? And we've kind of invested a lot in making sure that we pivot our private cloud solution around the application. So you will see that, you know, the Microsoft private cloud solution has made how you kind of has simplified how you would manage the entire application lifecycle. And we also want to make sure that we give you a lot more visibility and insight into what's actually happening inside your application, right? Versus thinking about the VM as a black box, right? We want to make sure that we give you a set of tools to give you a level of deep insight and rich diagnostics so that you can sort of figure out what's going on when something goes wrong with an application, get down to root cause, and reduce the time to resolution, right? I mean, again, so just bridging that developer and IT pro and making sure that that partnership is very strong is something which we certainly want to do. And we as Microsoft believe that we are best at doing that. We want to make your lives easier by kind of ensuring that we are all about the app, right? Second thing is around cross-platform from the metal app. And this is the time when I get some weird looks from a lot of you saying, gosh, Microsoft and cross-platform? Yes. So we want to make sure that our private cloud solution is more interoperable than any other solution that's out there, right? So we, again, want to ground this in the reality of where you are, right? You've told us that your data centers are heterogeneous, right? A lot of you are minimally evaluating multiple hypervisors, right? If not already deploying them in production. A lot of you have investments, you know, in other management tool sets, right? Be it from HP, BMC, or whoever it might be, right? And you're saying, gosh, we want to make sure that we carry forward what we have, we're able to interoperate with what we have, right? So that is the basis for what we are doing with being cross-platform. So our Microsoft Private Cloud solution supports multiple hypervisors, right? Be it Hyper-V, or VMware, or Citrix. We've, through System Center, we are actually allowing you folks to build hooks or interoperate with other management tool sets that you might have. You know, you'll be also surprised to know that System Center manages, you know, roughly 21% of System Center customers use System Center as their primary tool to monitor Linux and Unix. So again, these are significant statements of Microsoft's commitment to being cross-platform.
And I think cross-platform is important as well. If you're starting to think about moving towards a Microsoft solution, you know, you might be working with other hypervisor vendors today. You've just got hit by the V tax. You now have to pay twice as much in costs, maybe more. And so if you're starting to think about gradually moving to Microsoft, remember, cross-platform management is still an advantage that you can utilize today. Keep your existing environment, start deploying the Microsoft environment, and using that Microsoft environment, you can still maintain and operate those existing environments. So again, this move to the private cloud is gradual. It's not an all-or-nothing switch. You don't have to suddenly drop your existing providers, move straight to Microsoft. It can be a transition. And with System Center 2012, again, with being able to manage VMware and Citrix, we give you that ability to gradually make this transition.
Great. So the next thing is around this notion of what should be the application platform and virtualization platform that that I should use as the foundation for my future, right? And again, you know, what we want to say here is we actually have done a bunch of tests recently with comparing Windows Server 2008 R2 Hyper-V with a bunch of workloads like SQL, like Exchange, and SharePoint versus VMware, right, on a like-to-like comparison. And what we found is that Hyper-V is actually equal to or better than VMware for all of Microsoft's workloads that we tested, right? So again, that's a strong statement of the fact that Hyper-V, even today, is enterprise-ready. And I'm sure that, you know, if you folks are following some of the reports around Windows 8, we are also investing significantly in making sure that our platform is a lot more robust and enterprise-ready than what even it might be today, right? Again, these are statements of strong commitment from Microsoft to, you know, to the Microsoft private cloud and to our virtualization platform, right? You should have absolutely no doubts that we're committed to be totally enterprise-ready to meet your needs there so that you can choose us as being the foundation for your future. And finally, you know, we realize that this is a journey, right? And all of us are taking this journey at different pace. You know, all of us are at a different starting point in terms of where we are on this physical, virtual, private, public continuum. So we want to make sure that whatever we deliver through the Microsoft private cloud solution is on your terms, right? So if you're an IT pro, you've got the full flexibility to be able to sort of delegate authority to your application owners as you're doing stuff. You retain full control of the data center environments. If you're an application owner, we want to make sure that you are empowered with a set of tools to sort of enable self-service for what you're trying to do, which is to deploy applications faster and in a more cost-effective manner for your business. So either way, right, whichever way you cut it, through our common technologies that we spoke about, right, common identity, management, virtualization, and development tools, we make sure that we start where you are and carry your existing investments and skill sets along so that you don't need to reboot or retool yourself to take advantage of this, right? It's just recognition of the fact that we are all evolving and versus looking at this as being something which sort of completely breaks what we are doing today, right? So those sort of summarize the Microsoft Private Cloud, and hopefully it gives you a flavor of how we are different, right? Now let's get specifically into the System Center part of the conversation, because we believe that, you know, through the rest of this session and the next couple of days, you will get a lot of, you know, insight into how System Center is key to enabling the promise around the Microsoft Private Cloud, right? So it's good to ground us on where System Center is coming from, right? So again, System Center, we've been in this management business for the last 17 years or so. So we started with SMS 1.0, and it was back in the mid-90s when we were seeing a proliferation of Windows devices, right? And customers were saying, gosh, help me manage all of these desktops, and we are seeing a variety of them. So we built something called SMS, and now which is called System Center Configuration Manager, right? That was really the start of the management business. And then in 2000, when we were getting close to actually releasing Windows Server 2000, NT was already in market, we actually were releasing Active Directory. That was the time where we actually saw a lot of pickup of the Windows platform in our data centers. And again, you told us, gosh, give us a solution to make sure that these Windows servers are reliable and available and performing and so on, right? So we came up with MOM, right? I don't know how many of you guys have been with us through MOM, through now, but now it's called System Center Operations Manager. Then we built a couple of point solutions, one focused on backup and recovery, which was Data Protection Manager. And then a few years ago, we actually noticed this trend around server virtualization, right? Which is why we built Virtual Machine Manager. And we kind of got the feeling that, gosh, this might be really the beginning of much more bigger things, like, you know, more advanced levels of virtualization and cloud computing. So we were at this point where we were only focused on Windows infrastructure for the most part. And we said, you know, we need to round out our portfolios with something which can actually interoperate with some of the other investments you have as well, right? And capture a bigger percentage of management in your data center. So a couple of years ago, we acquired a company called Opalis. And you'll see later that we've renamed this System Center Orchestrator. But this is a category-leading automation and workflow engine, right? And what we were discussing earlier around, hey, how can you kind of focus on bigger things by automating repetitive tasks and driving a level of predictability? So Opalis helped us do that, right? And get a level of heterogeneous support going as well. And then a couple of years ago, we built Service Manager, which was our process management engine. Again, which can be inherently complex, right? So if you look at solutions like the service desk from BMC or HP or whoever, this tends to be a pretty gnarly affair. So we actually wanted to simplify it with Service Manager. And then a year or 18 months ago, we acquired AviCode because we thought, gosh, we need to make sure System Center is moving up the stack to sort of getting more and more visibility into managing applications. So we acquired AviCode because we also saw synergy with Operations Manager and the fact that AviCode was best in class to manage started applications. But so now we were at this, you know, crossroads where we said, should we kind of do more of the physical and virtual stuff that we've already been doing so far? Or should we invest a lot of our incremental focus on solving for the cloud? And based on all the data that we saw, we just said, gosh, we need to really make sure that we are pivoting most of our investments in System Center 2012 around solving for private cloud and public cloud scenarios, right? So that's been our focus with System Center 2012. So you should think of System Center 2012 as being one integrated product with a lot of those components listed to the right of your screen, right? So App Controller is a net new component that we've built from the ground up. We'll talk a little bit more about these components as we go on. But basically, it's one integrated product. So you'll see that these components sort of look similar to each other, right? In terms of the ribbon interface, in terms of the fact that we built a unified installer to make sure that, you know, you can actually deploy and configure these much easier, right? So what takes roughly 380 to 400 clicks for you guys might take only 20 to 25 clicks for the unified installer, right?
Yep, I've actually heard even better numbers. I've heard we've gone from 421 clicks down to 15.
Wow.
So let's give a quick overview of what is the unified installer. I've actually seen a question in the queue on that already. So basically, the unified installer, it's a single utility that gives you the ability to go and deploy all of the different System Center components. So instead of having one setup for just VMM, where you would go and run the configuration analyzer, you would install VMM server, then maybe you go install the database somewhere else, the library server somewhere else, etc. You basically go through this wizard, you click which of the System Center components you want to install, it takes you to the next screen, it asks you what are the default locations or what are the default servers for all of these different components, click that. What are the default storage locations for the various databases? What are the default locations for the various libraries? So again, we've gone from over 400 clicks down to 15. I think that's pretty cool. And so it's really going to help you if you're trying to deploy this at scale, get it up and running for the first time, simply to go faster. Less things to worry about, less configuration steps. So great question there, and you know, please keep them coming. We will be monitoring this live chat.
Yep, great, yeah. And as another example of the deep integration we've built in, Orchestrator has integration packs that tightly knit together all these components, right? So we have a lot of shared databases, libraries among all the components, so that System Center can not only talk, you know, seamlessly to each other or other components, but also talk with third-party tools with standard REST or database-based interfaces that we are building into Orchestrator. So again, very cool one integrated product that we have in there.
Right, and I do want to emphasize that point of integration. You know, as you saw from this roadmap, we had products coming out in 93, 2000, but really the current suite of System Center technologies, 2007, 2008, 2010. These products weren't all released at the same time, so they vary in the quality of integration, but today, one of the big focuses with System Center 2012 has been integration. The products are built at the same time, they're designed at the same time, they're developed, and they're tested at the same time. So you're going to be assured that there's a much greater level of integration and shared components across all of these utilities. So if you tried System Center in the past, found things were difficult, please try it again. And you can go and try it out today. You could go to the Evaluation Center, download it, and even download it in a single package. Yeah. So you don't have to go and download 7, 8 different components. A single package, you could get everything from our TechNet Eval Center.
Absolutely. So we've kind of redone the TechNet Eval Center. You guys should really check it out. It's a breeze. I can tell you, right, since I'm pretty close to the product groups, we've got 2,000 engineers who've been working on this release over the last 3 years, 3+ years. So I can tell you that, you know, I personally feel privileged at the level of, you know, unprecedented innovation that we're delivering with one single product called System Center. So, you know, again, just test it out because we think that it's worth it. Let's get into some more around how we actually came up with the vision for System Center 2012, right? We saw some background around our history and how we've come to one product, but let's talk a little bit about the path that we took to get there, right? So the first thing that we'll talk about is, you know, who do you actually interact with on a daily basis in your day jobs, right? So we actually said, gosh, we need to look at the primary personas who are responsible to deliver applications and infrastructure to the business, and who are they, right? So we characterized, you know, frankly, you folks as being, hopefully, right, you see yourself in the screen here where we say we've got a service consumer who is the application owner in a lot of cases, and we've got a service provider who hopefully is a lot of you who offer data center administration and services to those application owners, right? So, yeah, go ahead, Simon, you had a question.
Oh, no, I just wanted to point out, we have polls going throughout the day, so please, if you click on one of the links in the polls, you'll get some more information from you. And we want to know, what is your current role? Are you more of this application owner, or are you more of this infrastructure specialist? So please, complete the polls, and we'll try to tailor the course as well to a little bit what our audience is like.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, one key design point for System Center was just, you know, so far, right, we've kind of addressed the needs of the data center administrator for the most part, right? So we kind of understand and recognize a lot of you folks, the classic IT pros. But with System Center 2012, we actually have pivoted to solve some of the issues that application owners have in terms of delivering applications faster and cheaper and so on and so forth, right? So that's kind of, look at that as a net new addition to the System Center family, if you will, in terms of persona and focus. So let's look a little bit about what does the application owner care about, right? What are some of their requirements? You will have to be empathetic to these guys because these guys are facing a lot of pressure from the business, right? Everyone is saying, gosh, I've heard that cloud computing lowers the time it takes to release a new application down to a few weeks or months, and we are really away from the multi-year release cycles that we used to have with on-premises software. So these guys are under a lot of duress from the business to deliver things faster, cheaper, at higher quality. Right? So what these guys are looking for is a sort of frictionless interaction, a frictionless experience dealing with IT, right? So these guys want to make sure that their Sunday evening experience, right, going to Amazon.com and ordering something, is pretty similar to their Monday morning experience when they come to you and request a piece of infrastructure, right? So that's what these guys care about, right? And we want to be cognizant of that. Similarly, a lot of you folks are data center administrators, or classic IT pros, would care about things like, gosh, my budget is going down year on year. and I'm asked to do more with less, right? So I have to be very cognizant about cost efficiency. And I also am the steward, or I'm the keeper of valuable corporate resources, right? So I have to make sure that I protect all the data, and I have to be absolutely paranoid about things like security, right? And I've got to have this level of oversight and control over the data center infrastructure so that I can perform my role well, right? So you will see that, you know, these roles are kind of tend to have, you kind of tend to go a little back and forth, because you just, you know, it's a little bit of a challenge to reconcile all of these expectations, right? So we wanted, you know, both of these personas, or a lot of you, to come on the same page and have a common mental model or a way to think about, gosh, what can we do better for the business jointly as a team, right? And we call that mental model IT as a service, right? So the context being this world of hybrid IT, and we want you folks, frankly, you know, the dev and the ops, to sort of come together and join hands and deliver IT as a service to the business, right? That was really the vision around System Center 2012. And we think that this is very pivotal to enabling the promise around the private cloud. So let's talk a little bit more about what the capabilities it takes to deliver IT as a service, right, between the application owner and the data center administrator, right? And how does System Center actually fit in, and how do all the components sort of integrate together to deliver on those capabilities, right? So first, let's talk about what are the capabilities that are required, like I was saying, right? So the first thing, like I was saying earlier, is that the application owner needs a simple self-service experience, right? It could be a set of standardized cataloged items that they see that they can easily pick and choose from, or they would say, hey, I've got a multi-tiered .NET application, right? Here's the code packages, here are the SLA requirements I have, here are the compliance or the data privacy needs that this application has, and by the way, I need a report every couple of weeks on how the application is doing. These could be the set of simple requirements that might be collected through a self-service portal. But then what happens after that is a lot more involved, because IT takes over from that point onwards, right? It's a simple, easy experience for the application owner, and then IT needs to translate those application requirements and encapsulate them into a, you know, a mechanism or an engine, and we call that service delivery and automation, right? Basically, the service delivery engine would sort of capture and break down all the tasks required to deliver on this application and capture them as a set of change and release management requests, right? So a lot of you folks are paranoid about process and control. I want to make sure that we give you that service delivery engine. At the same time, there needs to be an automation engine that defines all the workflows that need to be in place to actually deploy the application to the underlying infrastructure, right? And do a lot of automation around that, and make sure that you don't need a lot of human touch than what is required. And then you've got a set of configuration and deployment tools to actually that listen to the service delivery engine and actually deploy the application to the infrastructure. And you see that the infrastructure could be physical, virtual, it could be set up in a private cloud-like deployment model, or in some cases, if the application allows it, you can even go to a public cloud like Windows Azure, right? And once you actually deploy the application, you need a set of tools to sort of monitor and operate the application to keep it healthy, make sure you're able to deliver those health reports that the application owner requested, make sure you're protecting the data that the application has, and so on and so forth, right? So think of this as being the set of, you know, capabilities that are required to deliver on this vision around IT as a service. So the next question is, how do the System Center components deliver on all these capabilities, right? So this is how. So we've got App Controller, which is a new web portal that actually acts as that application owner self-service experience when they want to deploy an application and configure it, right? We've got Service Manager, which enables a set of great service catalog-like experiences where application administrators can go and actually request private cloud capacity, right? Then we've got System Center Orchestrator, which is that automation and workflow engine, which does a lot of work in pulling things together and integrating them, right? We've got Service Manager, which actually offers out-of-the-box automated processes, right, around change management, release management, incident management, problem management, and so on and so forth. And then we've got a set of configuration and deployment tools in Virtual Machine Manager, you know, for virtual and private cloud deployments. We've got Configuration Manager, which is a solution to deploy and manage physical servers, right? And then we've got Operations Manager, which actually does a great job in monitoring the entire stack, right, down from the physical resources, to the virtual infrastructure, to the applications themselves, right? And then we've got Data Protection Manager, which again is doing backup of your virtual servers, your file infrastructure, and also your workloads like Exchange or SQL or SharePoint, whatever the application might be. So again, this is like an end-to-end view, and you should think of this as being a practitioner's view on what are some of the capabilities required to deliver IT as a service, right? We look at those as being classified into three broad buckets, right? The first one is around application management, right? So you need a set of tools that can allow you to sort of configure and deploy applications and monitor and operate applications, right? So you'll see a later session which actually drills down more into that, right, and shows you a bunch of great demos. Similarly, you need a set of capabilities around service delivery and automation so that you can do all of this in a very structured fashion and leverage automation in a big way, right? That's key to the private cloud promise. And finally, you've got infrastructure management, which you need a core set of tools to make sure that you can create private cloud infrastructure. And once you've created private cloud infrastructure, you can manage that infrastructure in a reliable fashion, right? So these are the capabilities. You'll see a lot of demos over the next couple of days, actually, which spotlight each of these in turn. Go ahead.
That's a great explanation of just the broad overview of all of these different components. You know, a lot of people think about private cloud and say, what are the required components? So we just really, really want to emphasize System Center 2012 is one of our key components, along with Windows Server 2008 R2 Service Pack 1. So talking a little more about the server side, you know, we do say that you want to use 2008 R2 because that includes such key features as live migration and cluster shared volumes. So with live migration, you can move VMs between different hosts with no downtime. Now, Service Pack 1 we explicitly say as well because this includes features such as dynamic memory. This gives you the ability to get better density, better consolidation ratios on top of a single host. More VMs, better consolidation, hopefully that will lead to more cost savings. But of course, if you need this advanced management, all of this advanced management is really going to come through using System Center with System Center 2012. Now, in just a minute, we're actually going to go and walk through all of the different System Center components. Are you ready to start to talk about these? So I think, first of all, let's talk about App Controller. Now, you briefly mentioned this is kind of our self-service portal. Let's take a dive and really explain, what is App Controller? I've heard of it previously referred to as Concero, as its code name, but tell us, what does this really do?
Yeah, so you should think about App Controller. Just a moment while we've got a couple of
additional
segments to go. That's fine. I think we can actually take the components first and then sort of wrap with this section if you're good with that. So let's give a brief overview of what the components are like, right? So App Controller, basically, you know, you should think about App Controller as being our self-service experience for the application owner, right? So it's a web-based portal. With sort of role-based access for the application owner. It actually brings together in one single pane of glass, right, all the applications, be they in private clouds or be they in Windows Azure. But what's interesting for you as the IT pro is that you delegate control to the application owner for what they can see, right? You as an IT pro have access to all of the applications and all of the VMs as well that are running in your data centers, right? So I think that's a pretty important statement for you. Because we've seen a lot of cases where you believe that your application owners are sort of working around you, right? I mean, there's just this popular perception that, gosh, IT is not fast enough to meet my needs, and I'm going to go directly to the public cloud and provision stuff. So this is a great way, or App Controller is a great way to bring all of those delegated resources in one single view, which you as an IT pro can sort of delegate to your application owner, right? They get the level of empowerment and agility they need because they can go there and actually deploy, configure their apps on their own. You don't need to get in their way at that point. But you still have a broad oversight and control into everything that's happening in the environment. So we think this is a very exciting sort of component that we are building into System Center as net new.
Now, what happened to the Virtual Machine Manager Self-Service Portal 2.0? Where is that in this release?
Good question. So we've been getting a bunch of such similar questions. And what we are, our approach to self-service is basically take all those capabilities and build them into System Center 2012. So what that really means in practical terms is we've built all the capabilities which were in the VMM SSP 2.0 into Service Manager, right? So you will see that Service Manager is the place where you should go to and request private cloud capacity. So that is what will help you create a sandbox for your application owners. So once those capacity, once the capacity is requested and granted, so application owners can then go to App Controller, and then they'll see some of their the application services they have access to showing up in App Controller, and they can go and sort of drain that capacity which was allocated to the portal. But that's a very good question. So you should look at App Controller as being the primary self-service experience to consume that capacity, and then Service Manager as a self-service experience to request capacity. So we've sort of streamlined how we look at self-service based on your feedback, based on our customers' feedback. So that's about App Controller. Next, I'll just quickly talk about Virtual Machine Manager. So basically, Virtual Machine Manager, if you go back to the previous version, it was essentially a virtualization management solution, but now we think of it as being our private cloud infrastructure solution. So what you can do is you can actually, you know, create a pool or a standardized fabric or a private cloud infrastructure based on, you know, which sort of clusters together all the existing investments you might have, be it Hyper-V, VMware, or Citrix, right? So again, that's a pretty critical piece of functionality that systems, that Virtual Machine Manager offers. Virtual Machine Manager also allows you to keep your private cloud infrastructure healthy and well utilized. So we built some cool capabilities called dynamic optimization and power optimization. So what it does basically is it allows you as an IT pro to set policy and say, you know, here are some of the thresholds for memory, disk, IOPS, and storage that I want to monitor. And if I go above or below in terms of utilization, then I can do a bunch of live migrations, make sure that my load is balanced across the cluster, right? And once the cluster is balanced, I can even look at time of day or whatever my business patterns are and shut down a bunch of servers without the risk of services going down through power optimization. So again, a bunch of great technology to make sure that we are optimizing and keeping your private cloud infrastructure healthy.
And this was similar to the feature which existed in the current system center technology. It's called PRO, Performance and Resource Optimization. But that required you to have Operations Manager as well as Virtual Machine Manager running, install the integration components, have them talk to each other. So we've really simplified this load balancing concept in System Center 2012. It's entirely managed in VMM. And beyond just this load balancing, we also have the power optimization to go and shut down these unused cores, shut down these unused hosts, so even advanced capabilities, and simplifying it using a single product.
Fantastic, yep. And what that does basically for you as an IT pro is, again, go back to the economics benefit that we were speaking earlier, right? So you can sort of carry forward what you have at one level and also drive up ROI by increasing utilization of your resources, right? Another cool thing that we've done with Virtual Machine Manager, is this concept of service templates. So what the concept of service templates is closely linked to the all about the app or the focus on the app that we were having earlier, that I mentioned earlier, right? So what it does is it allows you to actually work hand-in-hand with your application development counterpart and define a set of standardized application blueprints, right, which might include the hardware profile, the operating system profile, the application profile, right, front-end, middle-tier, back-end, and so on and so forth, and have some sort of an agreement that, hey, this is how we will actually create and build applications, right? So that once your application owners and you agree on what's a standard application, they can actually go to App Controller and do the actual deployment configuration, because you've actually done your job as a data center administrator in making sure that the infrastructure elements, which is the operating system profiles, hardware profiles, are consistent with some of those blueprints that you've defined. So again, it's a great way for you to actually streamline how application deployment happens, right? Today we've heard so many complaints from application owners as well as you, where you say, gosh, every deployment is a one-off, right? So we're trying to sort of simplify some of those challenges by bringing, again, the IT pro and the developer together, right? And service templates is a great way to do that as well.
And not only will we talk about this in more depth later, we're even going to demo this. So
absolutely,
we'll go into depth and we'll show you not only what it does, but how you can do it as well.
Absolutely. The good news is also that Virtual Machine Manager is an in-place upgrade. So you go from 2008 R2 SP1 to 2012 directly. Next is Operations Manager. Again, you know, this is something which a lot of you folks are familiar with, I'm sure, right? It's been around for a long time. So what we've done with Operations Manager 2012 is we've natively integrated application performance management into Operations Manager, right? So I spoke about AVI code and so on and so forth. So we've sort of integrated the AVI code technology into Operations Manager. So again, you can actually use Operations Manager as that single monitoring solution which spans, you know, down from the infrastructure right up to the application, right? So again, we've kind of simplified how you manage and monitor stuff, right? We've also built a management pack called the Windows Azure Application Monitoring Management Pack. You can actually go to Pinpoint, which is our portal where we store all our management packs and download it. But what it does basically is it extends your existing on-premises Operations Manager installation and extends that to monitoring Windows Azure applications. So again, we want to kind of make sure that you carry forward what you have, but you are able to have that single view to monitor private cloud applications or virtual applications as well as applications which you deploy in Windows Azure. Again, very, very cool. Another cool thing which we've done to make your lives easier and reduce the number of consoles you have to look at is we've built in network monitoring into Operations Manager. So it basically allows you to discover all the linkages between your network devices and how your application services are linked to them. So, and then you can sort of drill down into each of the network devices and see, look at their utilization, look at their health, and drive a bunch of reports around how those network devices are performing. You might have to kind of look at other network consoles for deep, you know, things like traffic pattern analysis and so on and so forth. But we thought, you know, let's simplify some of the basic things that you need from network monitoring and get that into Operations Manager. And finally, we've actually made it very easy to create custom application dashboards for you. So you can sort of easily create a custom report, you can publish it, you can share it very easily through SharePoint. So, you know, no one that you share your reports with needs access to Operations Manager. So again, very cool, you know, customizable dashboards that, again, you'll see demos of. So the key thing around Operations Manager I want to leave you with is this is, again, another way that we are bringing you closer to the application owner, right? In the past, whenever something would break, you would spend a lot of cycles, frankly, in talking to your application development counterparts and talking about, hey, was that an issue with the infrastructure or was that an issue with the application, and so on and so forth, right? So much time gets spent on that that you would be better off actually figuring what was wrong rather than, you know, the back and forth and finger pointing that we see, right? So through some of the deep application insight with application performance management, we are decreasing the time to resolution on those issues. Right? You can quickly go down to the line of code and see what's wrong and quickly alert your application developer and say, hey, it seems to be a SQL query and not a network or a server issue that you were talking about, right? Think about how easy it makes your life and some of the conversations that you have with your development counterparts. And again, this is an in-place upgrade from Operations Manager 2007 R2, so again, pretty cool. Orchestrator is a new component in the sense that it uses the technology that Opalis had, but it is our process automation engine, right? So it does, like I was saying earlier, right, it offers that level of deep integration with all of the system center components and also allows you to interoperate with third-party solutions, right? Our solutions from HP, BMC, CA, VMware, EMC, and so on and so forth. So again, we are carrying forward all that goodness into System Center Orchestrator, right? So basically, what we want you guys to get out of, what we want you guys to do is to get out of this business where you say, gosh, we created more and more tickets, and we actually spend more and more hours in office actually trying to solve for them, right? What we want you to do with Orchestrator is get to the point where you can ask questions like, gosh, what are some of the primary classes of these incidents that I'm seeing, and what can I do to actually automate them out so that I can drive remedial actions without even having to intervene or know that something was broken, right? So those are some of the things that you can do with Orchestrator. Just because Orchestrator works so beautifully well with Virtual Machine Manager, Operations Manager, and Service Manager, so they can drive a closed loop whenever an incident happens, you know, and automatically create tickets in Service Manager, and ask virtual machine manager to do some things to remediate something that was broken without you even having to intervene, right? So it's pretty cool stuff, and you should take advantage of some of the process automation capabilities in Orchestrator. And there is clear benefits to your organization as well, right? You kind of lower costs. You're actually increasing predictability by automating repetitive tasks and taking out the human error. So again, very, very cool. There might be some integration work that you might need to migrate some of your Opala 6.3 SS to System Center Orchestrator. So you might have to kind of, you know, do some fine-tuning of the existing workflows that you might have with Opala if you're looking to migrate those to Orchestrator. With Service Manager, which was our, you know, process management solution, we've actually built in a new service catalog and a self-service portal that I was talking about, right? Where we've integrated some aspects of the VMM SSP 2.0, but also allow you as IT to sort of create a set of standardized service offerings. Right? You can say things like, hey, I want my private cloud to have three different levels of SLA, right? There could be platinum, gold, and silver. You can actually set them up and the corresponding, you know, infrastructure as a service profiles in Service Manager, right? So your application owners can go and just select what sort of private cloud capacity they want, right, for example. We are also expanding what we are doing with release management, right? So that's a new module that we've added. We've also added a bunch of great reports around SLA management. We built a, you know, new data warehouse of sorts, which integrates with Microsoft Office. You know, if you guys are looking to develop some cool SLA scorecards, you should certainly check out Service Manager. You know, it's a great way to easily build those custom SLA dashboards, which you can use in your monthly operational reviews with your stakeholders, for example, right? Service Manager, again, you know, it allows you to increase the agility of your organization just because you can actually define those standardized service offerings and, you know, and expose them to your application owners who can just pick and choose on their own. And there is also an element of compliance because you want to make sure that you can track and audit what are the changes that you're introducing to your applications and to your infrastructure as well, for example. Configuration Manager, very quickly, we've actually made a couple of announcements. The first one is around desired configuration management because we are allowing the ability to automatically remediate any of your server configurations that go off baseline, right? So traditionally with Configuration Manager, we've had this capability around you know, DCM, but we've sort of enhanced it in recognition of the fact that there might be some in-guest management which will require this capability at a much deeper level. We've also integrated our anti-malware or our security solution with Forefront Endpoint Protection, as it was called earlier. Now it's called System Center Endpoint Protection. So it's kind of built into Configuration Manager. And what that means is basically you guys don't need to maintain separate infrastructures for security versus for configuration, right? It's all in one single infrastructure which is delivered by Configuration Manager, right? We at Microsoft actually integrated our Configuration Manager infrastructure with Endpoint Protection, and we found that we just had to add one incremental reporting server, and that too was for custom needs. So again, tremendous opportunity to drive savings and ROI for your organization in terms of combining and simplifying how these infrastructures work together. And finally, with Data Protection Manager, we have built in a new console, which is based on the Operations Manager console, just because we got feedback from a lot of you that it was difficult to administer and manage different DPM servers because we required a separate admin console for each of them. So now you've got the ability with this new console to manage up to 100 DPM servers just out of that console. So again, pretty cool. We've also built granular recovery for Hyper-V as well as for Exchange and SharePoint and SQL so that you can sort of get to what you're trying to recover much faster. So again, there is a statement around consolidation and savings with one single console for data protection server management and the fact that you can get and recover items much faster because of the granular level of protection that we've delivered. So this is a quick overview of all the components, and like we were saying, you guys will see a ton of demos which will demonstrate all of these concepts that we spoke about earlier in this presentation as well.
That's great. Thanks for the summary. Well, while you jump back to slide 20 to cover what we missed before, one of the questions that I've already seen asked a few times is, the private cloud is really talking a lot about automation, about building repetitive processes in. What exactly does that mean for the IT professional? Does that mean that the IT professional might lose their job? How do we answer that?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. We see this theme coming back time and again, and I wanted to sort of take this opportunity to clarify this. Right, we think that the concepts around automation that the private cloud offers is a great opportunity for you guys to actually stand up and show leadership in your organization. Right, we think it's an opportunity to actually give a fillip to your careers. So the question you should ask yourself is, what can I actually how can I aggressively pursue automation so that I drive out repetitive, daily, mundane tasks that I don't need to do, you know, that I don't need to keep doing, right? I mean, no one among us wants to receive a beep at, you know, for those of you guys, I used to carry a pager, which used
What's
to beep.
What's a pager?
At, yeah, it's like a, you know, it's like a thing that we used to carry when we were not in our shifts. So you'll get a beep or a page at 2 a.m. in the morning saying, this server has gone down, and we need to recycle the DHCP or DNS service, right? And think about how frustrating that would have been, right? So, I mean, just from my personal experience, the question that I would ask in a lot of the operational reviews I would drive with my team is, guys, don't tell me that, you know, we were able to address additional ticket volume without adding staff. That's not a measure of my success. So the measure of success I'm looking for is, how are we aggressively driving down incidents or classes of work which are high volume, which just keep on happening often and, you know, time and over again, and what are we doing to actually address that? So one of the things which I did was to just create a separate pool of IT pros who were focused on just managing problems, right, versus focusing on incidents. And those problem managers would actually come up with workflows to say, you know, here's an opportunity to drive down 10% of these types of patching work that we are seeing today, right? And here's a solution using a set of automation tools that we've recently built, right? So those are the ways you can actually look at driving out irrelevant work and focusing your time on doing more value-added services. And we think that this is a great opportunity.
Exactly. Add value to the business, right? If you're making more money for the business because you're making the business more efficient, you're adding a lot of value to the business. If it used to take you 3 months to do something, you can now do it in 3 hours. That helps the business. That helps your career. Yeah. You know, the cloud is coming whether we like it or not, so it's best to embrace it.
Absolutely.
You know, start training with courses from Microsoft Learning, from www.microsoftvirtualacademy.com, our free online training portal. And these resources will really kind of help you gradually start the transition.
Totally. I mean, I can tell you, right, we as Microsoft, we struggle to actually recruit professionals with highly scaled experiences and skills in operating and managing cloud services. So we actually think that this is a fantastic opportunity for you guys to say, to look at it and say, gosh, this is another certification which I must have, right? I mean, think of acquiring these skills as a set of competencies that you should absolutely acquire. Even if, think of the worst case scenario. What if all of these transitions that we spoke about today become the norm tomorrow, right? I mean, that, and you absolutely want to be prepared for that as well anyway. So in addition to some of the benefits that we spoke about in terms of giving your career a fillip, this is a way to say, gosh, how can I actually increase my value or my net worth as an IT professional and go and embrace the cloud? So if there are any other questions, we can address them, or we can actually take a few minutes to quickly walk through, you know, the solution scenarios that I was referring to earlier.
Why don't we wrap it up?
Sure. Let me just quickly give you a slightly more deeper flavor into some of these solutions that System Center is going to deliver. You'll see a bunch of demos on this as well, right? So the first conversation or the first piece around infrastructure management is, how can I make my infrastructure do more for me, right, and my organization? And the first thing you do is look at what you have, which could be, you know, a mix of different types of storage, network and compute, a bunch of different hypervisors like Citrix, VMware, or Windows-based Hyper-V. The first thing that System Center does is it allows you to pool these all together into one standardized fabric, which we call the private cloud infrastructure, right? And once you sort of pool these resources that I was speaking about earlier, you want to make sure that you have the right set of automation tools to keep your fabric healthy, right? So what that means is you should be able to immediately discover all the components of your fabric, you know, end to end, you know, storage, network, compute, and we allow operations manager to do that, right? I mentioned how we brought in network monitoring into operations manager console, right? We also have, once you've sort of discovered everything that is part of your private cloud infrastructure, you can actually see that something is wrong, and then you can do a bunch of things, like dynamic optimization and power optimization, right, which actually works between virtual machine manager and orchestrator and operations manager, and get your infrastructure up and running and keep it healthy, right? So basically what you're doing here is you're moving a bunch of virtual machines around, making sure that your clusters are balanced, your data center is being utilized appropriately, and your fabric is healthy, right? And once you've kind of taken care of standardizing your and pooling your fabric and keeping it healthy, you can actually deliver the fabric in a self-service experience to your business, right? And in this example, we are talking of the business as being represented by finance or marketing or HR, which are lines of business. They could well easily have been dev or test or production or geography-based, right? And once you've kind of divided your private cloud fabric and allocated it back to your business units, you know, let's say your marketing business unit wants to request more capacity, right? They can go to the service manager catalog or the portal that I was mentioning earlier and say, hey, you know, it's year in time and I'm seeing a lot of demand from a marketing campaign. So can I actually get some more capacity? So what you will see is you can flexibly allocate and expand the size of the marketing pool. So this is how you would kind of go from where you are today, which might be a bunch of different hypervisors and a heterogeneous environment, to one pool smooth fabric, which you can sort of deliver to your business in self-service mode, right? That's the infrastructure piece of the conversation. But then how do you standardize your applications, right? And that's what we call predictable applications, which is enabling and making sure that you've got a set of tools that simplify how you manage the application lifecycle so that you can deliver on predictable SLAs, right? And the construct that we have here that I mentioned earlier as well is a service template, right? So think of service template as being this sort of blueprint within Virtual Machine Manager that allows you to work with your application developers to define, hey, here's how an application should look like. It's got these three tiers, which is a web tier, an application tier, and a data tier. It's got these requirements from a, you know, hardware and operating system profile perspective. And importantly, here are the scale-out rules for each tier, right? So what that means is you're defining what are the thresholds behind which your application should scale up or scale down, you know, to the point that Simon was making earlier. You can actually say, here are the health thresholds as well, right? Alert me if this web tier is going to go down below 99.95% availability, right? Here are the maximum number of instances that this web tier can scale up to, right? So you define some of those scale out and elasticity rules as well in the service template. And once you've done that with agreement with your application owner, you can actually delegate control to the application owner to go to the app controller, which is our self-service portal that we were saying earlier for app owners, and they can go and visualize how this entire application service is built, right? So you see that there are these multiple tiers, and there is also the virtual infrastructure that supports your application service, right? At the end of the day, a virtual machine does not exist in isolation, right? It needs to be in context of the application service that it's supporting, right? So again, we want to encourage you guys to go away from this mental model of thinking about machines to thinking about application services, right, which have some of those scale, elasticity, and self-service agility benefits that we spoke about earlier, right? And this is a fantastic way that we are delivering with an app controller for our app owners to actually look at our applications and deploy themselves. Once you've deployed, you know, you see that you can discover the application immediately in Operations Manager because we have a sync connector that works between Operations Manager and VMM. You can drill down to the line of code which might have been causing the problem in this example, right? So you can go down to the SQL query and say, gosh, this is what was causing my application to not perform well. And you can actually send that to your development counterpart to fix. Again, right, bringing the dev and app guys together. So you've got a healthy service, and I want to just close off saying, you know, the last part of this conversation is we think that customers are, you know, you're going from just being traditional and virtual to private and public as well, and we want to offer a single pane of glass to you as well as to your application owners, which you can actually delegate control to. you see one pane of glass here, which actually allows access to your VMs, you know, in the context of the services they support, your private cloud applications, and your public cloud applications. This is the app controller view, or the single console that works across clouds, right? So again, you know, we are actually allowing you to adopt the cloud on your pace and in your terms. One final thing, I'll just close.
Final slide,
yeah. One final slide, guys. I know we are 5 minutes over time here. So basically, like we've simplified the product and integrated it into one single product called System Center 2012, we're also simplifying how you buy it, right? So we are just coming up with two SKUs. The first one is called System Center 2012 Data Center, and the second one is called System Center 2012 Standards, right? Both these SKUs will have all the components that we spoke about earlier. You see all those components listed, right? The only difference is that we are recommending that you use System Center 2012 Standard when you have high virtualization density, and you use System Center 2012 Standard when you have low virtualization density. So sorry, Data Center will be used when you have high virtualization density, right? And remember, we are still licensing these based on processors versus the VTax or the per VM licensing that VMware has chosen to do. We want to make sure that we give the benefits of cloud computing. So as you drive more and more scale in your virtualization and management environments, we want to return those economic benefits to you and not fight cloud economics that VMware is doing, right? So this is very important for you folks to understand. And there's just a ton of documentation about these licensing changes on Microsoft.com. So just take a look at those. And we'll certainly, you know, clarify any questions that you might have offline as well on the same subject.
Excellent. Well, thank you for that summary. So hopefully from this module, you learned an overview of what is the Microsoft Private Cloud, what's the vision, how have we got there, and what learnings has Microsoft had over its experience over the past 18 years. How we really brought to the table to give you confidence that Microsoft is able to provide you with the best cloud experience. Now that we've covered the cloud, you've seen all the different System Center 2012 components that fit together, and now we're going to take a short break. Once we come back, I'm going to be joined by Kenan Owens, and we're going to go a little more technical, we're going to show a lot of demos, and we're really going to dive into understanding the private cloud infrastructure and all of the hardware elements that we need. We'll see you in a few minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.